sir, for the kind words, and it is really an honor to speak in front of you as a when you are a chair. And I must congratulate you for a very successful organization of this ACP IM 2021. And today I'm going to take you through a few and discuss what is the role and relevance of HCQ 400 milligram in the management of type 2 diabetes. As we all know, hydroxychloroquine has been used by almost all of us during the COVID-19 pandemic as a chemo prophylaxis. It was also advocated by the Ministry of Health and Family Welfare also, and I don't think anybody is left out in the hall who has not taken HCQs during the earlier time. And some of us might be taking this even now, and because I have come across many people who are taking it even now, even after the vaccination and everything. So HCQ is a very old molecule. It is available. First FDA approval was obtained in 1955, and predominant use we know is in RA and lupus. And it is also one of the drug which is in the essential list of WHO medications. And in 2001 for rheumatoid arthritis, and 2006 polymorphic light eruptions, and 2008 LE, and 2014 DCGI gave approval for diabetes mellitus. So what is the mechanism of hydroxychloroquine in type 2 diabetes? One is that inhibition of insulin degradation. Second is the reduction in inflammation. It also improves insulin sensitivity, and there is beta cell preservation also. So these are the proposed mechanism of action of hydroxychloroquine. How does hydroxychloroquine inhibit insulin degradation? As we know, insulin binds to its receptor on the cell membrane. There is internalization of the receptor insulin complex in the endocyte vesicles, and insulin dissociates from its receptors. As you can see, this is the diagrammatic representation that what happens to the, what HCQ does. HCQ causes alkalinization inside the cell, and this results in the inactivation of the insulin-dependent endocytosis. And there is less insulin degradation, and there is insulin is released as it is and ready to get ready. So this is the mechanism of action. We know that HCQ inhibits insulin degradation. As blood HCQ concentration increases, there is insulin degradation decreases, and blood insulin levels also increase. Also, HCQ reduces systemic inflammation, and you can see the change in the hsCRP levels from the baseline and at the end of the 6 months. There is a delta change of -1.5 to +-1.7, and there is a reduction in HbA1c also to the tune of 1.3 to +-0.7. HCQ also improves insulin sensitivity and beta cell function, and it has been seen that insulin sensitivity is improved by 20%, and beta cell function is improved by up to 45%. I will not go into the details of all these slides because it will be consuming a lot of time. HCQ also preserves pancreatic beta cells. And you can see on the islet of Langerhans, you can see in a diabetic patient and in a HCQ treated patient, the beta cells and the alpha cells, you can see there is a less inflammation in the beta cells and the alpha cells also along with the islet of Langerhans when the HCQ has been given to the patients. It is important to look at the first Indian phase 3 trial in which efficacy and the safety of HCQ was assessed. And it was a double blind randomized comparison with pioglitazone. And if you can see that HCQ decreased both fasting blood glucose as well as the plasma PPG. And there is also a reduction in the HbA1c. And at 12 weeks, if you see the change from the baseline was in fasting blood glucose, it is 21.13. In PPG, it is 39.35. In HCQ arm, and HbA1c was reduced to the tune of 0.56. While at the end of 24 weeks, the similar changes were persisting, and there was improvement in the values also. And this was a significant, there was a significant change in the fasting blood glucose PPG as well as the HbA1c. HCQ has also shown to have a positive impact on the lipid parameters, as there is a decrease in total cholesterol, LDL cholesterol, as well as the triglyceride level. And there is a marginal weight loss of almost 1.08 kg has also been reported. An increase of 0.73 kg was reported with pioglitazone when it was compared in the phase 3 trial with the pioglitazone. There are many international studies, and there is a which has been published, and it has been seen that use of HCQ was associated with almost 77% lower risk of developing diabetes in patients who were taking it for the rheumatoid arthritis. There are many international studies. Because time is less, I will not be going into the detail of all these studies, but all of them have shown that there is a significant reduction in both fasting plasma glucose, PPG glucose, as well as the inflammatory markers. And there is a significant improvement in glycemic parameters whenever it is compared to placebo. There are latest international presentations which are from the other societies like ABA, and this is the largest clinical data on SCQ and type 2 diabetes and real world study included 15-23 uncontrolled type 2 diabetic patients, and they received HCQ 4 milligram per day and with metformin sulfonylurea combination for 24 weeks. Compared with that, mean age of the patient was 51.3 years, and 1297 patients completed 24 weeks of therapy. And you can see there was a positive, good glycemic control, and there was a change in almost all the parameters at week 12 as well as week 24. And target A1C reduced by 7% in 34% of the patients, and less than 8% achievement was seen in 73% of the patients. So this is again the there is an improvement in the lipid profile. I will not go into the details of the data, but that is there, and we can discuss in detail. So HCQ could be an effective and well-tolerated therapeutic options for treatment of type 2 diabetic patients. There is real life of HCQ, real life use of HCQ type 2 diabetic patients uncontrolled on two or more OHAs without insulin. So there are many studies, but I would like to tell you that one of the most important data which I would like to show you is that safety and efficacy of 52 weeks therapy with HCQ, first inflammatory drug approved in India for type 2 diabetes. And this is again 600 type 2 diabetic patients, and 405 patients completed 24 weeks and 24 completed 54 weeks of study till date. And for analysis, patients were divided baseline on baseline high sensitivity CRP. So you can see there is a significant change in the mean HbA1c values at the week 52, and there is also a reduction in the high hsCRP levels in HCQ treated arm. So there was a study concluded that patients who have high inflammatory load and HCQ could be effective and well tolerated option in such patients. HCQ has been studied as an add-on to metformin and sulfonylureas. It has been studied in add-on to DPP-4 inhibitors also, and it has also been compared with SGLT2 inhibitors, as well as it has been compared with the combination insulin glimepiride as well as the metformin. With DEPA, there is also some data, and canagliflozin also it has been compared, and some real world data is also there. But this slide is important, and we know that HCQ reduces inflammation, and we have experienced in our clinical practice that whenever we give HCQ, sometimes we need to reduce the doses of the insulin if the patient is already on insulin. And this you can see in these multiple studies. And if you look at the study, you will find that there is a delta change in insulin, and you will find that almost 10 unit per day reduction has been made minimum. And in one of the study done by Arjun Baidya et al., and they found that almost insulin requirement came down by 30 international units per day. And there was a significant change in HbA1c also. So this is one thing which we should remember, that whenever we are putting our patient on HCQ, there is a possibility that insulin doses may be required, less of the insulin doses may be required, as we have also explained in the mechanism of action, because it delays the or it increases the life of the insulin and prevents the insulin degradation. DGCI approved HCQ in management of type 2 diabetes in 2014, and hydroxychloroquine is indicated as an adjunct to diet and exercise to improve glycemic control of patients on metformin sulfonylurea combination in type 2 diabetes patients. This is RSSDI DSI recommendation 2020, and they also make a significant note that hydroxychloroquine is approved by DCGI for the treatment of type 2 diabetes as third line therapy, and whenever it feels suitable, it can be added, though it doesn't find direct place in the CV protection is again very important, because we all talk about the CV safety and CV efficacy. So there are very proposed mechanisms by which hydroxychloroquine may be mediating its CV effects. And one of the study shows that this is the association between HCQ treatment and cardiovascular morbidity among RA patients. And this is study showed that there was a 68% lesser risk of coronary artery disease events in HCQ users. Also, we have shown that there is a beneficial effect on the lipid profile by the HCQ, and there is a reduction in total cholesterol, there is a reduction in LDL, and there is reduction in non-HDL cholesterol also. One of the study like keeps shown that HCQ may also be having, as we know that it is having some anti-inflammatory effect, and through that mechanism also, it may also be having an antiplatelet action. And hydrochloric, this has been shown that this may also be a proof of concept is there, and it may also be one of the mechanisms by which the CV safety or CV benefit is there. OXY trial is ongoing trial. It is for the prevention of recurrent CV events in MI patients. And more than 2,500 patients hospitalized for myocardial infarction has been there. And participants, they are going to receive active HCQ 300 mg per day or placebo for at least 12 months, and until 350 CV events are confirmed. So primary endpoint for this study is the composite of death, MI, hospitalization for unstable angina, urgent percutaneous coronary intervention, and urgent coronary artery bypass grafting. So this is sponsored by Helsinki University Central Hospital, and completion date is 2019. The results are still awaited. So HCP safety, from the rheumatologist perspective, if we look, then we know that hydroxychloroquine and hyperpigmentation is one of the side effects. Incidence is 7.2% after cumulative use of 6.1 years, secondary to bruising or ecchymosis. And if you look at the hydroxyl group in HCQ, makes it suitable for the chronic disease. And hydroxyl group in HCQ makes it different from the CQ chloroquine group. So limits its ability to cross the blood retinal barrier and causes fast clearance from the retinal pigment cells. There is a low statistical risk of retinal toxicity with HCQ, and less than 1% risk in first 5 years, and less than 2% up to the 10 years. So this is again the revised recommendation from AO 2016, and risk factor for HCQ toxicity, which may prompt screening before 5 years of drug therapy. It is important to note that if the HCQ dose is more than 5 mg per kg real weight, and duration of use is more than 5 years, and we are assuming no other risk factors, and renal disease is subnormal glomerular filtration rate is there, concomitant drugs like amoxicillin are being used, and there is a macular disease which may affect screening and susceptibility to the HCQ or the clinical. Screening frequency, baseline screening, fundus examination within first year of use, and then we add visual fields and SDOCT if maculopathy is present. Annual screening begin after 5 years of use, sooner in the presence of major risk factors. So these are the recommendations when, in the for the rheumatoid arthritis patient whenever we are using HCQ. Royal College of Ophthalmology 2018 recommendations on screening are that after this recommend that HCQ long term, that is after over 5 years, have a baseline examination in a hospital eye department, ideally within 6 months, but definitely within 12 months of starting therapy with a color retinal photograph. And patient should be referred for annual screening after 5 years of therapy. So these are the key considerations from the prescribing information. Whenever we are using a patient population, so data are limited regarding the use of HCQ during pregnancy, thus contraindicated during pregnancy and lactation. Safety and efficacy has not been established in children. And elderly patients are more likely to have decreased renal function. It may be useful to monitor renal functions. So observe caution in patients with renal and hepatic disease. The contraindications are that if there is any known hypersensitivity and retinopathy or pre-existing maculopathy of the eye is there, and retinal or visual field changes are attributable to any four aminoquinolone compound. Drug interactions, if there is insulin or other anti-diabetic drugs, there is likely to be a reduction in doses may be required, especially with and drugs that prolong QT interval and other genetic drugs like HCQ prolong the QT interval and should not be administered with other drugs that have the potential to induce cardiac arrhythmias, and antiplatelet agents and anticoagulant exposure needs to be accessible. So these are the key prescribing information. And the take-home message is that HCQ reduces HbA1c in the range of 0.9 to 1.3%. Additional benefit is there on the lipid, and the marginal weight reduction is there, though it doesn't cause any weight gain. And CV benefit in RA patients has been seen in terms of reduced CV events. OXY trial is ongoing in post-MI patients. In patients, in which patient we can use, it can be started with any patient, inadequately controlled of two or more drugs. Real risk of retinopathy after 5 years is only 1%, and after 10 years is 2%. So if we use it for more than 5 years, then we can go for a OCT in annual screening. With this, I would like to conclude the talk, and thank you. Thank you very much.